Good morning, church family. Thank you for coming to worship with us virtually again. As you will see, today we'll have a very kid and family feel to it. This is the fourth Sunday of the month, which if we were together would be a kids and families all together worship day where we'd have kids helping sing and we'd have kids reading scripture and we'd have the kids involved in everything. And so we've tried to recapture that today. So we hope it will bring you an extra measure of joy this morning. And speaking of extra measures of joy, by the time we all watch this together, Curtis and Kim will be officially married. And we just want to celebrate them. Make sure you get on social media and give them a congratulations. Check out the pictures. We know many of you came out last night to send them off with our little car parade. And we just want to celebrate them with an extra measure of love and joy this morning. So let's get started with worship.
Hey, Gracie Mae.
Hello, Pastor Curtis.
Are you ready to sing?
I'm ready.
All right, let's do this. One, two, three, four.
While we long to be able to be your community in one space, we're grateful that the church is not a building and that we are a community outside of those walls. We come to you from many places today. Some of us may be continuing to work and serving others on the front lines of this crisis. Others of us are working from home. Others of us are attending school or schooling children during the day while trying to maintain normalcy. However our days have been changed over the past weeks, may we be grounded and reminded in this time of your goodness and the strength that you provide. We pray for those facing health concerns. May you provide healing. We pray for those facing economic hardship. May their needs be cared for. We pray for those making hard decisions right now. Guide those in the medical field and politics and give them wisdom. And give us all eyes to use this time to look for your mercy and to live in the small, ordinary moments of life. Amen.
One, two, three, four.
I won't be wanting. Ekklesia, as we prepare to take communion together, I wanted to speak more to the kids for a minute. I wonder if you've ever been given something special from a friend or a family member that helps you remember them. Maybe someone made you a necklace and gave it to you that you can remember them by. Perhaps they sent you a card with a special note that when you're apart, you can reread and remember your friendship. Maybe it's even a picture that you have setting up in your house or your room that when you look at it, reminds you of that person. Or maybe you've been on a special trip or a vacation and you brought something back that helps you remember that place and the memories you had there. Well, just like those things, Jesus gave a special way for us to remember him. When he gathered with his friends, his disciples, he shared a meal with them and gave them a special practice that would remind them of him and would help them remember all of his teachings and the special time they had together. And it's for us too. It's what we call communion. So he gave them the bread and he said, "This is my body given for you." And he gave them some wine and he said, "This is my blood poured out for you. And when you eat and drink these things, remember me." So when we practice communion, we are remembering. We are remembering the love that Jesus has for us, that he is with us, even when we can't see him. Even when we feel lonely, we remember that he is with us. And so we take this bread and we drink this juice and we remember together. So today, as you serve one another in your family, I hope this will be a special time for you to remember. Remember that Jesus is with you and that he loves you. Thank you.
morning is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 23 and 24, and then verse 31 through 37. Hear now the word of the Lord. When Peter and John had been released, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard this, they lifted their voices to God with one accord. And when they had prayed, the place where they had gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak the word of God with boldness. And the congregation of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and not one of them claimed that anything belonging to him was his own, but all things were common property to him.
And with great power the apostles were giving testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and abundant grace was upon them all. For there was not a needy person among them, for all who were owners of land or houses would sell them and bring the proceeds of the sales and lay them at the apostles' feet, and they would be distributed to each as any had need. Now Joseph, a Levite of Cyprian birth, who was also called Barnabas by the apostles, which translated means son of encouragement, and who owned a tract of land, sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. The word of the Lord.
Good morning, church family. Thank you, Julius and Leo, for that fantastic, spirited scripture reading and the dramatic flourish at the end. That was spectacular. They've been cooped up for a while, so we'll grant them a flourish at the end of the scripture reading. Guess what? I am a married man. Well, technically, at the very moment that I am recording this sermon, I am not yet a married man, and I still do not yet have a ring on my finger. But if this were live, and if we were together, now at this moment, gathered for Sunday worship at Athens Drive High School, I would have been married for like 17 hours already. This amazing woman is my wife, and I am her husband. So watch out, world, because here we come. This probably goes without saying, but it has been quite the week. Last Sunday afternoon, I started moving woodworking tools from my shed into the garage at Kim's apartment. On Monday, we moved Megan in and got her set up in her room. On Tuesday, I finished prepping my house on Six Forks Road to be photographed for real estate photos. On Wednesday, I continued moving tools and other furniture pieces over to Kim's townhouse, which I will officially start calling our townhouse right now. Allow me to demonstrate. I moved tools over to our townhouse. On Thursday, I had the joy and the privilege of putting together the worship video contributions from Elena on harp and Laurel on background vocals, and the very talented Gracie May, who is skillfully representing our youth worship team on this fourth Sunday. And in all of the in-between moments, I also wrote a sermon. Today is part two of our new series in the book of Acts. And if you missed part one, I highly recommend that you go back and listen to it through our podcasts or through the videos on Facebook or YouTube. It was the story of the disciples watching this bewildering and jaw-dropping event of the ascension of Jesus as he somehow left this realm of existence and entered into the realm of heaven. And the disciples were absolutely entranced and completely mesmerized by this sight, which is totally understandable. But this response of the disciples was disconcerting to heaven. Apparently, Jesus didn't want the disciples stuck gazing upward with their attention up there, and so heaven sent down two messengers to the disciples to say to them, in effect, "Stop staring into the sky. He's going to be returning here. And here is where the real stuff of faith is lived out. Jesus is all about bringing heaven into this world," which is a theme that continues in our text today. The story that Julius and Leo read for us from the book of Acts is actually the ending of a bigger story. It's the denouement. And so this morning, I'm kind of doing what some movies do when they start with where the movie ends. like the movie Forrest Gump, which starts with Forrest sitting on a bench at a bus stop. He's at the bench virtually the entire movie, telling stories from his life to anyone willing to listen to how he came to be there. And so I'm sort of Forrest Gumping our scripture text this morning. I'm starting at the bus stop bench where things end, but going back to tell the story of how we got there. Our story today ends with Peter and John together with their faith community, and they are celebrating a miraculous sequence of events that included a crippled man being healed, an impromptu sermon to an astonished crowd, being arrested by the Jewish religious authorities, and then later released. The story and their release created much joy and worship and prayer within their faith community. And in the midst of all of this excitement and passion, the Holy Spirit fell upon them all. Luke then wraps up this whole narrative with a powerful description of what happens to a faith community when the Holy Spirit descends in power. And we'll come back to his description of this in a bit. But first, just like Forrest Gump, let's go back to the beginning of the story to fill in some of the missing details. It all started a day earlier when Peter and John had gone up to the temple to pray. It was 3 p.m, the time of prayer. And just as they were about to enter the temple, a crippled man was carried up to the temple gate and set down. He was placed there by his handlers to beg from those coming and going from the temple. As far as begging goes, this was a pretty perfect location. Lots of foot traffic. The story gives us a few details about this man who is placed at the gate. We know that he was crippled from birth, and we know that he is now over 40 years old. And so this was clearly not his first time begging at these temple gates. And he asks Peter and John what he asked everyone who crossed the threshold into the temple courts. Can you spare some change? He had no idea the change that they were about to offer him. There is a verse in Isaiah which anticipates this miraculous healing moment that's about to unfold. It's a verse written about Jesus, but it was penned some 750 years before Jesus was born. And it says this: He took up our infirmities and bore our diseases. We believe a day is coming when God will return and set all things to rights, and there will be no more infirmities or diseases. But we also believe that sometimes that future comes rushing into the present to meet us now. And this is precisely what happened here at the temple. Through Peter and John, Isaiah's prophecy makes a beautiful and powerful entrance as Jesus takes up this man's infirmities and heals his disease. Whatever it was that had kept him dependent on others to carry him and set him down at the temple gate to beg, that was gone. He danced and celebrated his way straight into the temple courts to find these two men who were instructive in his healing, these two men who told him in the name of Jesus to get up and walk. And this is where things start to turn south for Peter and John. When he went inside the temple, everyone recognized him. He was the cripple who was always placed outside the gate to beg. Outside the gate, outside the temple courts. This is significant. And he was healed. Even more compelling, the temple leaders and the temple system itself had nothing to do with this healing. For the leaders of the temple system, for the high priest, the Sadducees, and the religious leaders and others, this was problematic. The temple was the place where God had always met with his people. For the religious leaders, the temple was their livelihood, and they were the gatekeepers. They oversaw the entire sacrificial system which took place inside the temple. And this arrangement gave them a lot of power, economically, socially, and politically. They were the beneficiaries of this temple system. An event like this healing of this crippled man served to undermine this power. It's interesting to note how in Luke's gospel, the first book that he wrote, the book begins and ends in the temple. But here in Acts, in Luke's second book, he's letting us know that the good news of Jesus is now moving outside the temple. And as we continue in this series, we'll see more of how this happens. The temple leaders are afraid. In this act of healing, God's new world and new order is making an appearance. And in this new world where God moves and works and heals wherever and whoever he wants to, they can never hold the same power as they once did in the world as it was. Back to the story. This formerly crippled man is dancing and singing and simultaneously hanging on to Peter and John and won't let go. A crowd of Jewish worshipers have heard about the miracle that just happened, and they begin to gather around Peter and John. If you're familiar with the gospel stories, you may recall that Peter is a bit of a talker. What does a talker do when a crowd gathers? He talks. Peter launches into an impromptu sermon with some very intentional imagery and ancient references. He says, "This act shouldn't surprise you. And it wasn't our power that did this. It was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." There is only one place in the entire Old Testament where God is introduced in this specific way, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It happens in what is perhaps the most cherished of all Jewish stories, the Exodus. Peter is connecting this healing moment in the temple with that ancient moment. Peter is referencing God's calling of Moses to go back to Egypt to lead his people out of bondage and slavery, a story that all of these worshipers at the temple would have been intimately familiar with. By connecting what just happened to this crippled man with Israel's Exodus story, Peter is saying, God is doing that very same thing again. He is leading us out of everything that binds us and enslaves us. That is what you have just witnessed. That is what he did with this crippled man, and that is what he wants to do for the whole world. It's a powerful sermon that Peter is preaching. Continuing in the story, the temple leaders are not happy with any of this. First, a healing takes place outside the temple, and now crowds are hanging on every word of Peter in this powerful impromptu sermon. So what do? They have Peter and John arrested. There's just one problem with this. No crime has been committed. Except, of course, the crime of upsetting those in power by hinting toward a world where their power may be obsolete, which isn't legally a crime, but to them, this is criminal, and it must be stopped. Apparently, the day is already late, and they don't want to have to mess with questions and interrogations at this late hour, and so Peter and John are put in jail until the next day. And that following day, the who's who of the Jewish religious world gather to figure out how to stop this crime. Elders, teachers of the law, Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest's family, they are all present. The text seems to suggest that they all gathered first, perhaps to clarify their questions, and then they call for Peter and John to be brought before them. Here's their big question. By what power or what name did you do this? That is a big open-ended question. Clearly, they hadn't met Peter the talker before, because what does a talker do when he is given a huge open-ended question? He talks. Peter launches into yet another powerful sermon that first points to the absurdity of being arrested for a kindness shown to a crippled man, but then moves on to declare in no uncertain terms that it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. And here we arrive at one of my favorite verses in Scripture. It is definitely my favorite verse in the book of Acts. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. To be honest, that's all I really want. It's what I want for me personally, and it's what I want for us corporately. When I interact with people, all I want is for them to somehow recognize that I've been with Jesus. I have days when I'm pretty sure this happens, and then I have other days when I'm pretty sure people might think I've been with someone, but it sure ain't Jesus. Condensing the rest of the story just a bit so that we can get back to the bench at the bus stop where we started. The leaders send Peter and John out so that they can confer amongst themselves. The crowds were praising God for this miracle that happened, which made it hard to decide on a punishment. The Jewish leaders decide to warn them not to speak any more about Jesus, a warning to which Peter responds boldly with, "Which is right in God's eyes, to listen to you or to him? You be the judges." The leaders threaten them some more and then let them go, which takes us back to the bench at the bus stop where we started. As Luke tells it, when Peter and John are released and return to their friends, they tell the story of everything that happened. Their faith community rejoices and prays, and then the Holy Spirit falls upon them in a powerful way. Luke then moves into his denouement, the climax, the big reveal, the powerful description of what happens to a faith community when the Holy Spirit takes over. If this were a novel or a movie that adheres to the modern conventions of superhero plots where an unsuspecting person or persons receive an otherworldly set of powers, you would expect the next scene to be huge. The power of God has fallen upon them all. What's going to happen next? It's going to be huge. It's certainly going to be bigger than the healing of one crippled man. But very much in line with what we heard last week in part one of this series, it seems that the author, Luke, is now playing the role of the two men sent from heaven who said to the disciples, "Stop staring into the sky. He's going to be returning here. And here is where the real stuff of faith is lived out." And so, at the end of this dramatic account of a miraculous healing, of jail time at the hands of the religious authorities, and a powerful and mysterious encounter with God's Spirit, Luke surprises us all as the story does not keep getting bigger, but rather it suddenly gets tiny. Humility, selflessness, a desire to work for the good of others. And maybe that is actually the bigger miracle. Maybe that is far more remarkable than the healing of a crippled man, the healing of crippled, crooked, broken, selfish hearts. Oh, how we need the Spirit of God to descend on us in this powerful way again. I saw the most amazing video this week. It's of a young boy named Aaron Hodek. He's 9 years old, and he plays the bass guitar. In a moment, I'm going to play a clip of him playing the bass line to a fun, upbeat gospel song by Kirk Franklin called Love Theory. And if you don't have your subwoofer turned on, you should turn it on now. Or if you're only listening on your phone or your laptop, put on a pair of headphones so that you can hear the bass line a bit better. Here it is. It's amazing with you. I wouldn't even have to. Everything's working for my good for always. Come on. He saves the day. Woo. He's my conduit. I think we all know that's not what superheroes do. Hallelujah. No prayer. That's why. kid is officially one of the coolest kids in the world. When I saw that clip, I was blown away. If you are not a musician, perhaps you can't fully appreciate how amazing what you just saw was, but let me assure you, it was amazing. I know I already said this, but he's 9 years old. I've shared that video with a handful of different people this week, including someone I consider to be the best bass player that I know, a friend of mine up in Canada, and he wrote back to me saying this: better groove than me, better technique than me, better riffs than me, even better bass face than me. If I were to close my eyes and only listen to the audio of that clip, when I open my eyes, I would expect to see someone like Victor Wooten, a 55-year-old jazz, fusion, pop, and funk player who is widely considered to be one of the best bass players in the world. He is absolutely amazing. But when I open my eyes, that is not what I see. I see something completely and totally unexpected and underwhelming. I see a 9-year-old boy. In our story this morning, if we follow the expected trajectory of how everything should unfold, if we read this story through our relentless American lens of perpetual up and to the right growth, the story should keep getting bigger. When we open our eyes, it shouldn't end with, "and they shared everything together in common, and they lived humbly and self-sacrificially with one another." It shouldn't end with a description of humility and selflessness. It shouldn't end with a little 9-year-old boy from Slovakia. It should end bigger and bigger and even more dramatically. But it doesn't. And that is one of the great themes and most important storylines that Luke is trying to tell us. Yes, there may be a moment or two when the kingdom of God arrives in dramatic fashion, but that is the anomaly. That is not the norm. By ending this dramatic healing story and release from prison with stories of compassion and altruism, Luke is reminding us that the kingdom of God doesn't arrive in miracles, wonders, marvels, and astonishing feats. He's reminding us that the kingdom of God is much more unassuming. It arrives in kindness. It arrives in gentleness. It arrives in love and patience. It arrives in caring for those less fortunate. It arrives in letting go of some of your power for the sake of others. And living this way is precisely what the Spirit of God empowers and enables us to do. The gospel is quite shocking, but it isn't shocking because of the spectacle of it. It's shocking because of the simplicity. It's shocking because of its unpretentiousness. One final thought. There is so much sorrow, hurt, pain, fear, and uncertainty that surrounds us right now, that it is hard to even imagine or form a mental image of anything good coming from any of this. And maybe it is insensitive on my part to even suggest that something good is even possible. But maybe, just maybe, this season that we are in will finally break our addiction for the need for everything to always get bigger and better, for stock markets to always rise, for vacations to always outdo the last one, for houses to always get bigger, for bodies to always get sexier, and faces always to get prettier, and cars always to get fancier. If the trajectory of the gospel is one of humility and selflessness and working for the good of others, perhaps our lives should resemble more of that as well. Let's pray together. Holy Father, thank you for Julius and Leo and their scripture reading flourish. Thank you for Gracie May and the many other talented young worshipers who normally sing and play on Fourth Sundays when we're able to worship together. Thank you for the reminder this morning from your word, but also from these young men and women, that the kingdom of God most often arrives humbly, in small packages. It arrives wrapped in grace, kindness, selflessness, care, love, and the laying down of power. Father, we see the impact of your Spirit falling upon the early church, and we crave the same to happen again. Fall upon us that we might live more compassionately and freed from our addiction to needing everything to be more and to be bigger. God, your kingdom come, not ours. Amen.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Cover.